Okay, call the meeting to order at 6:44. Minutes, we don't have minutes.
We don't have any for next time.
Okay.
We can do that, we can do that.
Okay, schedule appointments, Lynn is not ready to present anything, so we'll move on with some of the, one of the new business items on the agenda. John, you wanted to talk about fire trucks and equipment.
We have a fire truck that needs to be declared surplus property. It's sitting out back at the fire station, I'm sure everybody's seen it. And as I understand it, you guys have to declare surplus property, and it has to be offered to other, all the other department heads, and then it has to go to town meeting vote, unless another department head wants it. And my request would be that you actually donate that truck to the fire, to the firefighters association, so that we can buy 4-inch hose, because we didn't have enough money. And it has 4-inch hose on it, but it's very old. And it, all the 4-inch hose is on it, I think there's 1,100 feet on it. It's all past the annual test, but it's very old. It needs to be replaced, and that's what we would do with that money.
For the new truck?
Yeah.
And help me here. 4-inch hose as opposed to what other inch hose do we use?
Inch and a half, inch and three-quarter hose, or 2.5-inch hose. It's that big yellow thing you see.
Supply hose.
It's supply hose, goes between pumpers, goes from fire hydrants to pumpers.
Okay.
So move 1,200 or 1,500 gallons a minute through it. Or you can pump it up through the center of town.
The old hose would go with the old truck then?
There is no old hose. The old hose is on the new truck.
Oh. But once you buy new hose, what are you going to do with the old one that's on the new truck? You going to still use it then?
Based on once a year when we test it, there's sections that fail every. Okay. So within a year or two, it'll be obsolete.
So if I'm understanding correctly, we can either sell the fire truck through the town.
Yep.
And you're going to come to us with a request to purchase 4-inch hose, which we would use the revenue from our selling the fire truck, or you can do it yourself.
Right.
And you can reap any difference that might exist between the sale of the fire truck and the...
Well, I don't have to go beg it from Paul.
I get it.
That's the bottom.
I get it, and no one likes to do that.
I know.
I haven't.
I don't have any problem with that, but didn't we give him the $5,000 to buy it?
We already gave $5 a foot.
No, I'm just saying, we already gave you $5,000.
The $5,000 was for equipment and inch and three quarter hose, and there was a lot of hose on this truck there.
Again, I had no problem.
Off the other one.
I just was.
And the 2.5-inch hose.
So I have no problem with it.
If you expended the $5,000 on other important hardware for the truck, and I'm assuming that if Brian asked, you could give him a line on a rundown of
course.
$5,000. Right. Yeah. So I.
And then some.
No problem.
And then what?
And then some.
And then some.
Yeah. I have no problem letting him dispose.
No. So I would make a motion to.
Can I just talk about the process real quick?
Yeah.
This is Chapter 41 of the Whately Code. So. John's made a declaration that the fire truck is surplus property. So under the code, the board would offer the surplus supplies to other departments, boards, committees, and commissions. And if nobody wanted it, then we would dispose of it five ways. One is we could throw it out. The other one would be a charitable donation, which is what John's talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Trade-in when making a purchase, a public auction, or sealed bids. The catch with the charitable donation is that it requires town meeting approval because you're giving the item away for less than fair market value. So this would become an item for the special town meeting.
So would it be easier then if we were to sell it as surplus property and we'd still have to go to special town meeting to give the money that we sold, to, yeah, so either way, we're not avoiding a special town meeting.
But isn't there a $5,000 limit on it? If it's less than $5,000, you don't have to go through all that process? Can't you declare it?
Yeah, of course, if the town hereby approves the procedure to dispose of surplus property that's been net value of less than $5,000. This is our procedure to dispose of property less than $5,000.
Oh, okay, less than $5,000, okay.
Nobody knows what it's gonna be.
Yeah, do we have a monetary value on the...
Of the fire truck? I got a loose scrap metal alone is $5,000, more than $5,000.
No.
No?
Would it last, the highway truck went for what, 10?
That did go for 10, yeah.
That was a dump truck.
That is value.
Still had more value. The problem with this vehicle is it's too old to be really put in service anywhere else, and at the same point in time, it's too new to be considered like a collector's item. If it was a 1930 or a 20 something, that it would have a much higher value because it would be...
Great, John, take it to the Big E.
A collector's item.
Yeah, that's true.
It's not there yet. It's not old enough for that, but it's too new to be, you know, it's in right. That...
Well, aren't we going to have a special sometime?
Yes.
November, yeah. So,
can you wait that long?
Sure.
I guess you got no choice.
But how do we do it with the dump truck? Do we have that at town meeting?
Approval the dump for truck went to, we asked...
Was it a warrant article at the town meeting?
Yeah, was declared surplus, but that went straight through to auction.
Right.
Okay. Through the auction procedure and the cash.
Because we got fair market value for the dump truck, and we're not going to get fair market value for the fire truck if we give it away, essentially.
Right.
Right.
That's why special town meeting is required.
Right.
Yeah. And John, the department had to submit a letter declaring that the property be declared surplus, and in that letter he sets an estimate of what that value is, which is $4,000.
Okay. You've been looking for a new police car. You could use this.
I understand what you're reading is our procedure for disposing of property. Is there a lesser one that, I mean, we're not going to change it probably for this instance, but we need to look at that for something less valuable than that? I mean, we're going to have stuff in two buildings to dispose of, desks and furniture and all. And if you're going to follow that to make it available to other people or in an article at town meeting?
You got to go to change that. You got to go to an article at town meeting.
Well, yeah.
Right. Let's cross that bridge.
The charitable donation is the part that requires a special town meeting.
Okay.
So if you're disposing...
Yeah, we might not do charitable donation for desks and chairs and other stuff. Try to sell.
Sell it, okay.
So what were you going to say?
No, I was just going to say that on town floor someone will ask what's the value of that truck.
Right.
So that has to be known at some point in time.
It's a tough,
as a ballpark.
It's a guess.
As a ballpark, right. But you got to throw a number out there.
Yeah.
What did this one at Craigslist go for? Was it another one? Got one off Craigslist.
It was a much newer one. I think an 84, 85.
They just bought that straight from Northfield.
Yeah, but it was on
Craigslist.
I didn't see it there, but that's what I read. But
have we tried to sell this thing, or there's just no way?
No, it's town property. I can't sell it.
Have you sniffed around?
I have people who want to buy it.
Oh, for $4,000.
I don't know what you mean. Mr. Prochesnik's willing to pay for it. I haven't asked him.
Well, he's got one already, doesn't he? Right.
Yeah, what they'll do is they'll either put a tank on it, or I've been told these, the fire pumps on these are not good for irrigation, and that's the only reason anybody would want it, is for irrigation. Any farmer would want it. What they would do is they cut it off, build a dump body on it, and or put a flatbed on it and put it on the field, put fertilizer tanks on it, or put bulk bins on them.
Okay.
That's what I've seen.
I say with Fred, I would argue that we just put it on the town meeting warrant.
Sure. Okay. Yeah, I have no problem with that. Okay.
Okay.
I'll field the question to town meeting.
Yeah.
You and Brian will work with that on that question.
Yep. And he also, he has another letter on there.
There is a second letter.
A few years ago, we acquired and we're responsible for the safe trailer for the county. And we own the trailer. The town of Whately owns it. We did all the paperwork and collected the titles and registration is all in Brian's hands. I think you got it down the hall the other day. I took it off my desk. It's in your folder now.
It's in my file.
In any case, we applied for a grant and we had a new safe trailer delivered. In the snafu, the guy that ordered it spent too much money. He came over his budget.
Mm-hmm.
So we went to Bolex, who made the new safe trailer, and they agreed to split the difference of the overrun, which was $4,000. The firefighters wrote a check for $2,000, and Bolex absorbed the other $2,000. So we have this old trailer, and our theory was that when we dispose of the old safe trailer, it would be given to the firefighters and they would get their money back. Same procedure.
And again, I don't know what the value of the safe trailer would be.
Springfield is looking at it. And I've been told he put a price tag on it at $2,000.
I'm wondering whether it would bring more than $2,000 because it's a trailer and there are a lot of purposes that can be served by a trailer. Maybe I'm wrong.
It's modified. It's a safe trailer. It's not.
You couldn't use it for a variety of recreational purposes or?
No. This thing weighs a ton.
It's been modified to the point where a little, you know, there's like a second floor in it for the little kids to, it's not, an adult cannot go everywhere in that without crawling.
So what's a safe trailer?
Still New Orleans, a fire education is safe.
They're part of the school once in a while.
They take it to the school, and it's a county, we're responsible to allow any community in the town of Whately and in Franklin County to use the safe trailer for educating their children.
I guess my only point is, do we want to make sure, and I think we probably do want to make sure, that we get a maximum return on this kind of stuff? And while obviously you don't want to spend a ton of time on what could be a fool's errand, but do we know that the city of Springfield's offer of $2,000 is what we're going to get? Again, because that question will be asked on town meeting floor as well.
We could still put it through like one of the online bids.
It could.
And if Springfield wants to bid their $2,000, somebody else bids $3,000, then.
And then you guys would get your $2,000 back in the time to get the difference.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because we want you to get your, I want you to get your $2,000 back.
Mm-hmm.
But it's going to come up in town meeting floor, as it probably should.
Right.
So I, you know, if you can take it for a bidding test run, I don't know how to do that.
You want me to tell Mr. Kennedy that, or you got, that's what they want?
Oh, who's Mr. Kennedy?
JP.
Oh.
Am I safe educator? The one that's been working with Springfield to try to sell this, so.
Got it. I don't know, I just think we should,
JP.
I think we should check to see what the fair market value would be. So, and Paul's point is a good one. It's gonna come up, so let's do our homework first.
So we're gonna do the same thing as we're doing with the truck thing? Declare it surplus and article it to special town meeting?
Right, and then the association will be responsible for maximizing the return on it.
If we get more than what we're owed for, then The town
get the money, the difference of the two. You guys will get your money back, and then the town will get back the difference.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, just and back to the truck. So, whose name is, who has the title for the truck? Is it the town? So, do we need to switch the title to you? How does that work? When you sell it, then the town signs off on the title?
Yes.
Does the title have to go to you first? Because you're.
I don't think that would be a real issue. I think if Brian signs it or whoever signs the title, or I sign it as the fire chief, it will go to the whatever you know, wherever it's going to go. And that would be sufficient.
I don't think we got to move the title.
Is that what happened with the truck then?
Again, I don't think we have to move it too many times.
Same way, okay.
Okay, so that, so both those warrants will be, or articles will be on the warrant for the November town meeting. Okay. You want to take Jim?
Okay, yes. Anything else, John?
Thank you.
Keith, you, did you want to go to the firefighters meeting at 7:30?
Yeah.
They can go be a part of it.
That's all right. I just, basically, I'm here, I wanted to, a couple of things on the agenda that I wanted to be here while you discussed the complete streets. And just also talk to you a little bit about the BRI program, which is the small bridge program under 20 feet. Do you have the complete streets on the agenda? Do you want to start with that?
Sure.
Just to update you, Brian and I met with an engineer in regards to the complete streets. At one point we had talked and we weren't sure if we should apply for the $50,000, which can be used for the, what's the technical wording on that? The $50,000.
It can be used for technical assistance.
Right, technical assistance. So yep. We did talk to this engineer and he highly recommended that we go that route and apply for it. And he showed us some examples of what his firm has prepared for other towns in this. And after we had this discussion, Brian and I both felt that it was, would definitely be beneficial. The package that they can prepare for that $50,000 will be a lot better than what we can do on our own.
Who is doing this? Who's preparing the package?
Well, that's, we only met with one engineering firm. We don't have to do any type of procurement. We can just go with that firm if we wanted to. They're probably as good as anyone else that we could also, you know, but it's not like we don't have to do a request for proposals or anything like that. The procurement laws allow us just to pick an engineering firm and do it. And so that's pretty much where I just wanted to update you where that's sort of lining up. And in that $50,000, what the town needs will do in that is we need to come up with our entire prioritization plan of the entire, of all of our things that we have envisioned as projects that could be, would be eligible under the Complete Streets program. From there, Mass DOT will take that prioritization plan and review it and approve it, which then takes us into the next step, which we actually would have a apply for projects.
Does it give you a better chance to get money for projects?
I think, again, that it's free money in the sense that it's part of the program that you don't have to apply for this technical assistance, right. But we certainly have nothing to lose but only to gain from applying for it.
And the projects are based upon the conversations you've been having with various people in town about incomplete streets over the last couple of months.
Correct. And that the report that's coming to your board from the ad hoc committee from the Conway School of Design, you're going to get that real short period, definitely before your next meeting, you should have that. And at the same point in time, when we bring in an engineering firm, they'll look even in a bigger scope. There's other areas in town that have potential needs for sidewalks and other things that this project will encompass. So that will look at the big picture, not just the center of town. And we will come up with a complete prior citation plan, and then we will move forward.
Okay. So the 50,000, that's up to 50,000 you would get, and that would the money will pass through to this engineering firm that would do the work for you, so it wouldn't cost the town.
Correct.
Anything. Okay. Is this something Bay State Roads could do?
No.
Because they have...
Bay State Roads does not do any of that.
They have some programs for prioritizing, well, like pavements and certain aspects of the highway, but not, I don't know.
No, they are, it's Bay State Roads, more just does education.
Okay.
They do not get into any of the, anything like this, what we need to do.
Okay, but they have program for pavement condition, don't they?
Once in a while, every so many years, they'll have a class on pavement management.
Pavement management systems, right. And don't they offer assistance to towns to do that?
No.
Or set that up or anything, no?
Okay, so you guys have talked about other engineering firms that could accomplish our tasks.
Yeah, I think I think following it up, what I would do with Brian is if we meet back with this engineering firm that we did discuss this with, and if they have can be something that done in a timely fashion. If they're not able to do that, we can look at somebody else. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, the next steps would be to select a consultant and then work with a consultant to develop the specific scope of work that we want to be done under the $50,000. And then we would submit that scope of work that we've worked on with the consultant to Mass DOT for approval. And then once they approve the scope of work, they review it and approve it. And then they would, we would get the notice to proceed with the...
And the $50,000, is it just the development of a plan? It's not the actual work. Right. I was going to say, you're not going to get much done for...
No construction, no design.
Nothing, just no plan.
Just once plan. You apply for the up to $400,000 for implementing your project, when are you expecting that to be available? Next construction season, or is this going to be another year beyond that? Do you know?
To be honest with you, I think the way that, certainly in our case, we would not be looking at project until 2018. 2017 is not like, we're not going to make it for that. But at the same point in time, the money, there's half of the money that's out there was supposed to have been, it's budget money, and it's supposed to have been all spent by June 30th of 2017. It's budget money. Yeah. However, there's only two projects statewide that are ready for construction. And so there's what they're saying is, even though there's a deadline of June 30th for this first round of funding, there's no way that it's going to be able to be spent. So they're going to have to make some concessions.
Okay.
But to answer your question, I don't feel that we would be ready by any means to make the first round, which is supposed to be construction and totally done by June 30th of 2017. And we haven't even got a plan. Right. So we're not really that much different than a lot of other communities. A lot of other communities are in the same thing. That's why I'm saying this program is sort of lagging behind as things have been moving forward.
So what's the timeline, do you guys think? I mean, I see two months for the document you guys have put forward. Then what happens after this process? Then what's the timing on the rest of it?
Once we would apply for the funding aspect of it, if we're successful in getting it, then depending on if the project can be done within the amount of money, then we don't need anything. If it exceeds the amount of money, then we're either looking at possibility of Chapter 90 or town funding, some other sources. There may be an area also where some of the other things can come into play. I haven't even, until we know what our exact plans are, it could be other sources.
But it's fair to say then that we also can't, if we applied, got blessed, we still wouldn't be able to, we can't start anything until the new fiscal year. I mean, it can't bridge fiscal years, I can't imagine. Work,
this
actual work.
Would be.
So starting in the spring and overlapping into the, my guess is...
When it's this projects like this, just like my chapter 90...
Doesn't matter.
It rolls.
It rolls over, okay. I didn't know there was separate. Okay.
If the state gives us this specific money, like in the past, if you remember, we've had other programs, pothole money or things that, when they give budget money like that, they were tied to, had to be completed by June 30th. But...
Okay. But the, is there a deadline for the, when you expect the 50,000 for the planning?
No, that's
It's a rolling.
It's a rolling.
Yes.
Okay. So what do we need to do, anything, or just are you keeping us informed?
Just want your authorization to go ahead and apply for the 50,000 technical assistance.
Well, yeah.
Perfect.
Why would we say no?
Yeah. No reason.
Sure, I guess.
I just need you to say yes.
Go ahead. Go ahead. And the other thing.
Yeah, the last thing I just wanted to update you. You know, as you know, we have the other project program that the state recently came out with is the BRI program for the small short bridges. One of the things in filling out the application, and I know it's on your agenda, is in the way it's worded on the application, I can only assume that it would weigh in our possibility of getting that money is the community compact. It's asking if Whately has already done the community compact.
And we haven't.
And as you know, we haven't. So before I can submit this and say we have, I don't want to put down that we have and have them look at it and say, geez, we haven't. Or I don't want to say we haven't if we're going to.
Well, it's my goal, just speaking personally.
I don't know anything about it.
Try to expedite the community compact as much as possible because we are behind on that.
Okay, I don't know anything about that other than it's in this application.
Yeah.
But do we have bridges less than 20 feet?
Yes.
Yeah, Haydenville Road.
Williamsville Road,
I'm sorry. Yeah.
And they're out.
And they're closed.
Right.
One is closed, and that's why,
And we've been trying to solve this
It fits the bill perfectly.
3 years now. A little more.
I want to get right now. It's competitive, but we can only hope that we're ready to go. We get it.
Yeah.
Well, what's just the community compact? That thing you just described earlier.
I don't know what it is.
It's essentially the avenue that towns will need to take to procure any state funding for infrastructure projects going forward. To be in line, you have to demonstrate that Brian, you could probably describe it better. I'm going to butcher it, but it's their method of making sure that you have your ducks in a row to move forward on infrastructure projects.
Is this something new?
Within the last year.
So you couldn't phrase it in pursuit.
Well, I don't.
And try.
I mean, if it's something that the board. If it's something that's already on, and I notice it's already on your agenda.
Well, if you want to sit here, and we'll see what happens in the next agenda item. It's not a difficult process. It's just a little bit time-consuming, and we got to do it. And other towns in the area have done it.
I get the feeling that if you have the community compact done, you get a check.
Right.
And you get credit for that, and it helps you in your process.
And if you don't have it done, you can walk away.
You just don't go to the top of the pile.
I think you're at the perpetual bottom of the pile if you don't do it.
Okay.
So.
All right. And then also, I just wanted to quickly update you on the trees situation at the school. At a meeting, Ryan was there. And some representatives from the school department, we met, we discussed things. Actually, I believe they have a meeting tonight, and on their agenda is to make a formal recommendation vote from their board to purchase or look into purchasing a property. They couldn't make that recommendation to you until they have a formal vote. Also, one of the outcomes from that meeting is I'm in the process of getting an estimate. I said I would do it because I've been involved in most of the tree work so far. I was getting an estimate on a reestablishment of this meeting.
Of what?
Screening trees.
Yeah.
They're going to have an estimate to have it, the trees replaced where they were, and also an estimate of having the trees put out at the property line if the town, doesn't mean that we're going to do it right away, but just starting the process of coming up with that.
I mean, the reason those trees were planted there to begin with was to quote unquote protect the school from pesticide spray.
Or just.
I'm not entirely convinced that a row of trees is going to.
Oh, were they planted there, or were they?
No, they were planted there.
A lot of them were transplanted.
Transplanted,
were they?
Yeah.
When they moved, they came in with tree spade, and a lot of them were removed.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm not convinced that a row of trees solves that, but maybe someone who knows that stuff better than I do. But I, you know, if that's what they want to do, that's what they want to do. But
why would you put two rows of trees there?
That's what there was before.
There would be.
I know you had the barn before.
The barn was there also acting as a.
As a buffer.
But again, that wasn't on the property, on the town's property.
Right.
The trees were.
Okay, but I would think you'd want just one row of trees so you could. They wouldn't be in the way of future use of that land, whatever it is, whether it's recreational, or parking, or
we're
whatever.
We're getting two estimates, and if the town chooses to pursue, and the planning wouldn't necessarily be done until springtime, for instance.
Yeah.
There's no, nothing's really going to happen. The fields are done as far as any pesticides, anything going on is done in that aspect.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing would take place in with these fields until next spring. By then, hopefully, we will know what the town's desire is with this property. If they want to just keep what they have, then we know we got to put the screening back where it was. If the town is going to goes through and purchases the property, then the screening can go back at the property line. And then you've got the open area if the town wants to expand the parking lot. The discussion at that meeting was even discussed if, you know, maybe it could be established as gravel for the time being if you wanted to have an overflow area. It doesn't have to be paved parking area, but. Did I miss anything else that we discussed there, Brian?
Are they considering, let's say, a fence or something? For
the fence was not, did not, they did not want a fence.
If you're worried about the pollution coming from
the fencing area, to create a brand new massive wall fence type thing was discussed in regards to graffiti and be a maintenance nightmare in a whatever the life expectancy of when it starts to rot, you'll be back to having to do the thing all over again.
Well,
and it'll end up costing more. What's that?
Well, then maybe the vegetation would be up in 6-8 years to take the place of that.
It's going to take a lot more time than 6-8 years to.
Well, we wouldn't be putting trees. In 3-foot trees either.
What's that?
They would not be planting 3-foot tall trees. They'd be planting substantial size trees.
And the town would become ample with that money as well?
The insurance.
Oh, insurance going to cover that.
And is there a limit on the insurance for that?
The insurance limit would be $100,000. In my discussions with them, if we spend $100,000, they would consider that unreasonable.
Okay, so less than that.
Yes.
I would hope substantial.
Is the land they're considering the area where the barn burned?
Right.
That's a
parcel.
Yeah.
And
how big a parcel is it?
0.8 acres.
0.8
If there is an issue regarding health for the children in that school, I think the town should put the onus on the school committee to determine through whatever means they have to get experts in there whether or not a row of trees, shrubs, or fencing is going to abate any of those problems. And if not, then that's another decision.
I tend to agree with you. And maybe it does. Maybe, you know,
wiser heads than I.
I mean, it might. But it's the school committee that should put the time in to make that determination. So then, if there is a problem, the town can now go back to the school committee and say,
you put the yes on it, you said it was a go, rather than the town shouldering that responsibility.
Well, yes, the school committee is the town. It's our school committee.
Yeah, but it's, but he's saying, but I think what Paul's saying is this, that the onus would be on the school committee to have said, this is the fine, these are the facts that we have uncovered, that it, in terms of health, and obviously we want to protect the kid's health if it's going to do it. I mean, you think about...
Their last meeting, this is exactly what they were discussing.
Right, you've got a row, you've got the land that I think Pachesnik farms down the driveway.
Yep.
And potatoes, and that's just a thin row of trees, and I'm sure he uses the same stuff that's, so I...
Sure he does.
I'm trying to figure out how, I mean, I've got a kid there too, so I really don't want to, but...
Paul, we addressed this issue at one of our other meetings. The select board said to the school, we want a recommendation from the school board on the parking, on the lot, purchase or not, or do something with trees. It's not a town issue. Well, it is, but first we said we wanted something from the school board.
Right.
So we have addressed that already once. Now it's up to them to come to us and tell us what they want. Yeah, Keith is helping, but it's not strictly a town decision to put up trees or purchase.
I'm also curious how many nights they are exceeding their parking capacity to the road. To the extent that people are parking on the road. Obviously, town meeting.
It's both. It's both the town and the school.
I get it, but how many is that?
I don't know.
Yeah, I mean,
six.
The band, what's that?
It's about six.
Yeah, months. The band concert, parent night. You know, there are mm-hmm. probably a handful of nights that the school does it, and there's one town meeting.
Usually once.
A year where you have that kind of crowd.
Yeah.
So I think we should do some level of cost benefit in terms of, is the money that it's going to take to buy the land, to pave, if that's what they choose to do, worth the amount of traffic, no pun intended.
But it also pushes that farmland further, the usable farmland, because it's already been said by the owner that they're going to offer, where the barn was, is going to be offered up for...
An extension of that land.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that the crops and the chemicals are going to come right in. Up to the
right.
Closer.
I would think no matter what, the town should buy that land, whether it sits there,
it's
bottled forever.
I'm not convinced of that. I'm looking for a reason. I'm looking for, other than if you wanted to add parking.
Well, let's say in 5 years the school closes and we now move our town offices to the school.
Yeah, but...
So now we're going to need more parking.
There's a lot of woulda, shoulda, couldas there.
I understand, but it's called foresight.
Well,
you know, how often does a piece of land come up abutting
a small piece of
town
park?
The value is minimal, Jonathan. It's less than $1,000. It says value is very minimal.
Okay.
It's not a $30,000 parcel that
I guess my point is, somebody should do their homework in terms of what the purposes might be so that it's sellable and so that people can see, okay, they understand. As Dan, if Dan is correct, it's foresight. Well, what's that foresight? Because you can also say it's foresight on going in a different direction. Let's get our ducks in a row before we do this. Because, we're going to be asked at town meeting. And how many times do we get asked at town meeting, we don't have an answer for it, and we're embarrassed? Let's do it right for once, rather than waiting for someone to ask the questions we knew were coming and we chose to ignore.
Well, we should get something from the school committee by then, right?
At yep.
the next meeting, maybe, to tell us what they're thinking and use of the land.
Yep.
Yep.
Is there a time frame on it?
I mean, as far as establishing a screening, you would want to do that at this point in time. Was figured on doing it first thing in the spring.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so, but in terms of sale, whomever is selling that land, they don't have a time frame for, I need to sell it by X.
No, it's not like being marketed right now.
No, I did speak with Alan Sanderson about it.
Mm-hmm.
And
okay.
It wasn't for an immediate decision, but the sooner rather than later.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, it seems like a timely, so I would
I would send something, I mean, I think the town needs to tell the school committee, give them a date. We need something from you by this.
I believe it was on there at the time. Isn't that correct?
It means tonight already.
Tonight already?
I think it was tonight.
I think so. Because they made the comment that you're.
Are your kids home alone?
Both meetings for tonight, so.
I think it's supposed to be for the day.
Yeah.
I think there's an all-school board meeting, like all four schools on Thursday.
Right.
Frontier and Union.
Yeah.
I thought from our meeting that maybe.
The same night, that was scheduled the same night as two of the open houses, but that's besides the point.
The last thing, it's already, I didn't have any objections to the board hearing.
Okay, I was going to ask you that before.
All right.
Okay, moving up, we've got 7:15.
Should we do the?
We got to.
Should we do the?
Jim, sorry about this.
Is somebody here from Eversource?
Well, I'm here from Masterson because I'm a resident.
I'm sorry, you're here from where?
I live on Masterson Road.
Oh, okay.
I'm a resident, so I wanted to attain this part of the meeting to find out.
Are you from Eversource, ma'am?
No.
No. Okay, we don't have anybody here from Eversource, but.
So probably good to do, do you mind waiting around a couple of minutes?
Sure.
Do the poll hearing, we should probably do the poll hearing because it's advertised for 7:15.
Yeah, I'd love some background.
Go ahead.
So we have a petition from Eversource, let me pull it up here. So petition for pole and wire locations from Eversource, Energy DBA, Western Mass Electric, request permission to relocate and or install poles, wires, cables, and fixtures, including the necessary sustaining and protecting fixtures along and across the following public way. Location, install two solely owned Eversource poles on Masterson Road, beginning approximately 150 feet northeasterly from the center line of Masterson Road. The purpose to extend power to feed lot number 5, and there is a site plan in the packet of the two proposed pole locations. And Keith had checked, he went out and checked out these locations and he said they were okay.
There's no objection from the highway department.
You're talking about this one?
No, that's the school.
That's the school one. Where is this plan?
Yeah, it should be in the packets, right here. Where's the front, yeah. Right there.
Because I don't have it.
Oh, okay.
To lot 5.
Yep.
I'm on lot 6, I just wanted to make sure that nothing, I have a pole already on my lot, and I just wanted to make sure we just paved our driveway and did all of our finished stuff, that we weren't going to be adversely affected by it.
Have you seen the layout?
I haven't, that's why I'm here.
The poles are marked out up there.
Okay, because I have a pole already, so. Okay, so it's in between.
This will be further to the north.
You saw my pole, right? Did you see my pole, you're familiar with it? So is it in, it's after that pole?
Correct, two poles further to the north.
Okay.
The 3321 and 3322. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
And what's, okay, you're on lot 6, so you, what's on lot 6, you have a house there?
I have a house there, yeah, it's almost completed, but I have a pole already on it and we have power already going to our house. And I was just under the assumption that if there were going to be poles that come down, they'd come down the street or up off of Dickinson to give power to those individuals. Because there is 1, 2, 3 lots privy to my prior, but we're situated right now. So that's what I was just wanted to make sure, because then I saw something about possible underground and all that, and he's panicked that somebody wants to rip up our driveway to do something.
He just did it 2 days ago.
We're like, wait a minute. And I said, no.
2 days is a long life for these things. You guys should be grateful for the 2 days and.
We like to cut pavement around.
Yeah, we just want to make sure.
I just go up my house and half of it, cut the whole end of our driveway off, it's never seen again.
So.
And what's on lot 5, is there a house there now?
Lot 5, yes, there is a house and a barn.
It's under construction.
It's under construction.
I
That's a big one.
Substantially large. So you can tax them a lot more than you tax me.
So these poles would be on town property?
They're in the town.
Yeah, right away.
What's the right away width there?
40 feet.
40, so they're showing 22-foot road, so you've got...
They're about 6 feet off the edge of pavement, somewhere right around there.
So you've got 9 feet to the line.
They're definitely within the town's layout. I looked at them today.
Okay.
We've got no problem from fire, from highway?
As I said, they're off the road. And the main concern I had was just to make sure they didn't impact. Sometimes we have subdrain, there's utilities underneath that are owned by the town. I just made sure that there was no utilities.
And you're all set there. Are these people's concerns?
This is aerial, so it won't be...
It's all aerial?
Yep. Just a continuation of what's there.
So...
So they're above-ground poles then?
Yeah.
Okay, because I saw, we got a notice saying something about underground poles. I'm like, wait a minute, that could be weird, so...
They're marked up clearly with a white stake, and if you want to, when you travel up there, you'll see them.
Okay.
So no one's doing anything underground up there?
I don't know. You'll be dealing with this in the near future too, again, with Camoso's lot, which is further north, which is at the intersection of...
He's put a foundation in right now, so...
They're going to get power, unless they keep continuing...
On Masterson?
Close the loop. They may decide to come up from Dickinson Hill Road. I don't know if their plans are to close the loop or leave it open-ended. I don't know.
The gentleman who's building on the lot after Camoso's, he's planning on starting next year, is what I was told. So that's why I was thinking if there was any issue, they could just come up right off Dickinson Hill anyway, because it seems to make most sense. Camoso's going to have a barn as well, so he'll need power to that, which is on the corner of Dickinson Hill. Running, his house will be up on Masterson, so it kind of all goes anyway. And I know he had been talking to somebody regarding this. He was having a little bit of an issue trying to figure out how he's getting poles up there, so I thought he would be here today to talk about it anyway, but I thought he was sort of involved in this because he needs power too.
The power to your house, is that going underground from the pole?
From, no, I have a pole, and then we have underground power feeding into the property.
Okay, because that's what you're saying here, that they may do that.
The houses can, well, the power is going to be aerial along parallel to the street. Each house can certainly put underground service.
But that wouldn't impact their land at all?
Because it's going to be another piece of property.
Right, and let's hope that Eversource is planning appropriately in terms of the different building lots that are...
Well, they would certainly, it would behoove them to do that, because it would seem redundant to keep going back out, doing the same thing.
Okay.
Can I ask another question real quick while I'm here?
Sure.
Our road is very nicely paved, and there was some talk about it being dug up and possibly oil put down there.
Oil and tar set up?
Join the club. That happened to my road.
It's not going to be dug up. It's, what's there now, it'll be, next year it'll be chip sealed, yeah.
Why? There's nothing wrong with the road.
It needs to be, yes, it does.
That's not going to ruin our nice cars?
No. No.
Well, I just was wondering, because it just, it seems like the road is perfectly fine. I just don't understand why that would be done.
For like one day, it's installed.
That's not that kicks up against your wheels and...
No.
Can't do that.
It's what the majority of the roads in Whately are.
Yeah, I've seen it that, and I'm not complaining of that. I'm just saying, it seems like a waste of money if you're going to do that.
Ask Keith which one of the people up here at this table was moaning to him about the very thing that you are talking about on their road, what, 5 months ago, 4 months ago? It just, you know...
If he doesn't seal it now, it gets under the cracks, controls it, and then we have to grind it.
Okay, let's move on. Okay, we have no problem with, I guess, recommend approving Eversource.
You need a sec? I'll give it back to you. I just wanted to make sure that mine wasn't.
You can keep it if you want it, but.
Well, I don't, as long as I know that it's not anything that's going to hurt what I've already done and paid for.
It should be staked out.
Okay, all right, I'll take a look at it tomorrow then.
Yep.
Thank you, and don't hesitate to ask questions if what you, when you look at it.
Okay.
And it doesn't seem right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Bug him.
All right, I will, thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Moving on, Jim, you're next on the agenda here.
Okay.
Thank you, Whately.
I just came in to give a quick, hopefully quick overview of just things that have been going on.
Dan, I can't hear him.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Just came in to give a quick overview of what's been going on as far as the police department's concerned. We are planning school lockdown drills this week. We've been doing lockdown drills in the district for the last couple of weeks. It's been going on. There's been some additional training going on as far as school safety goes. We're in the process of updating school safety plans. So that's what's been going on with the school. It's kind of an ongoing thing. We've been meeting quarterly. They decided to do it quarterly now, the school safety committee or team, however you want to call it. So at those meetings, we go over the plans and discuss lockdown drills and so on and so forth. So we'll be doing our first drill this week in Whately. And they're looking to do 3, possibly 4 per year as far as lockdown drills. They're looking to do an announced drill is usually the first one where everybody knows it's coming. The second one would be unannounced. The third one would probably be around recess or lunch where there's more confusion. And then this year we're going to try an organic lockdown, which is basically a lockdown that's started by somebody in the school and it's not given over the loudspeaker, so we can see how far. If somebody's in their classroom, we give them a note. Everybody's going to know what's going on, but we give the teacher a note. They then in turn would, you know, yell down the hall, you know, lockdown drill, and then see if it makes its way around the school, see, you know, kind of find those areas where we need to make improvements. So there wouldn't be somebody announcing it over the loudspeaker so everybody knew about it. So those are the 4 different types of drills that we're looking at doing this year. We've been doing school safety stuff for probably seven, eight years now. And just recently, we were invited to Covestro to do some training there. So we're kind of starting to expand out now into the manufacturing or the workplace safety type thing as well. So it kind of goes hand in hand. Some of the same things apply from school safety as they do in the workplace safety. So we did, last Tuesday, we did a training for all 3 shifts. They came through in different groups. So we just covered the basics on lockdowns, evacuations, shelter in place, things like that, just to kind of touch on it a little bit. But we're going to be working with them, meeting with their safety team, and kind of moving forward, developing a safety plan for that facility, and then going forward from there, practicing drills and things like that. Same, kind of similar to what we do at the schools. So it's kind of good that we're now branching out into the workplace safety with the manufacturer.
Does it make sense to let parents know that this is coming down the pipe at some point, just so that they're prepared? Because we all know how quickly word travels around here. Oh, there was a lockdown and half the people know it was a drill and half the people don't think it was a drill. And I really
as
think
far as
that
schools go.
Yeah.
It, usually what happens is for the first one, and again, it's up to the school to kind of announce who.
Yeah, but as the public safety officer, I think you could encourage the school to take that step.
Yeah, but what happens is if with the first one, it's announced, so everybody will know about it. They'll probably put something in a newsletter, let everybody know that it's coming. When we do the unannounced, if we tell everybody that it's coming, then it kind of defeats the whole purpose of seeing if the school is actually prepared.
I get that. I'm thinking, Jim, more in terms of you're not going to be told when, but don't be surprised if sometime this year.
And like I said, this has been going on for 8 years
right.
now. So it's when we first started off, we had a little bit of, you know, a learning curve. Yeah. But now we have no issues with it. I haven't had any complaints from parents
okay.
saying that, you know, this is happening, that's happening. The only issue we had was one time There was a media group that came out, kind of filmed some portions of a lockdown drill that we were doing, and they weren't, parents weren't notified that that was coming, so, you know, a couple of parents, and I think there was only two, that actually had an issue because they didn't know that the media was going to be there and, you know, filming the school and things like that. So that was the only issue we've ever had, as far as parents complaining that there's anything going on.
Go back to school, continuing. So who's actually in charge of the drill? The school, or somebody from school, or you, or?
Well, it's a team effort. So what we have as far as our team goes, the school safety team, when it comes to lockdown drills, it's the local police department. The schools are involved with it, usually the principal, and we have representative from the state police. The state police have a community action team, and I think they've got one more person coming on now, so they may have four people that cover from Worcester all the way up to the Berkshires, all of Western Mass. So they're responsible. They've kind of been tasked with actually developing the written plans because they have all the templates. They go around to all the schools. So when we do a lockdown drill at a school, there's usually representatives from the state police there, local police, all of the local police, usually somebody from Deerfield, Sunderland, Conway. This time that we're doing it, Hatfield will be coming as well. So we're trying to get as many of the local surrounding towns as we can coming into our district, because that's what's going to happen. You know, all of the smaller towns around us, they only have one person patrolling. So if something happens at our school, they're going to be coming from everywhere. So we want people familiar with our school. We want people familiar with our procedures. So it's kind of a team effort. There's really no one person in charge, so to speak, that says these are the rules. We kind of all discuss it at the school safety meetings. If there's some sort of change to how we do the lockdowns, we give them the information, them being the faculty, the administration at the school, give it to them. The principals all sit in the room, superintendent sits in the room. We have building facilities people in the room, firefighters and, you know, fire chiefs in the room. So it's really an effort of all of public safety across the board. And there's really not one thing that happens that says, okay, this is the way it's going to be because I say so. So there really isn't one person in charge.
So you're going to other towns that have that?
Yes. Yeah, we do it. We've been, like I said, we've been doing it for 8 years. We usually do it within the district. The goal, we did it once last year, but the goal was to do the entire district in one day. It didn't work this year for our first drill, but that's the way we like to do it, because then it gets everybody done all at once. Just for the fact of, you know, having to bring in the community action team, they could be here, there, wherever. They could be out in Worcester tomorrow and somewhere in Pittsfield the next day. So it's kind of hard for them to schedule. So they could be there as well. So we try to get it all done in one day.
How many from your department are involved?
We're all involved at some level. Usually it happens during the day. So I go to the drills, and then I bring any information, any changes or anything like that, I bring back to the department. I know Don's been before. A couple of our part-time officers have been to the drills. Usually when we hire a new person, we're going through the training. During our training, at some point, we'll have some sort of drill at the school, so we always bring, you know, new officers through the schools anyways to show them the schools so they're familiar with it. So essentially everybody's involved, but it's not always everybody there at one time to do the drill.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay. So that's as far as the training, safety training that's been going on. We've got training for our officers. Our training schedule has started for the year. The 40 hours of unfunded mandates have begun again. So this year, just so you guys are aware, the topics for our 40 hours training, on top of our legal update, firearms training, CPR first responder, defensive tactics, those are the ones that we do every year. In addition to that, this year we're doing a half-day training on active shooter, which will be a tabletop exercise, because believe it or not, there's still some towns, some districts that haven't developed plans yet, so they're trying to make that part of our mandatory training. Dynamics of addiction, you know, with the heroin epidemic that's been that's been going on. They're looking to give us some more training and the understanding the dynamics of addiction. Alzheimer's awareness is another half-day class. And then youth issues. There's been a lot of changes to juvenile laws, so they're kind of making that part of our mandatory training for this year. And again, that's 40 hours of training. Some building facility issues. We have a new hot water heater that was just put in last week. Our hot water heater broke. We've got a new door handle coming for the front of the building. It's a keypad door handle. The one that's on there now, going into the lobby, not into the police station, but into the lobby area. So the building's still secured, but the one on the front of the building is having some issues, so we're replacing, in the process of replacing that one. That came about more in the sense of we now have, and I'll be probably putting some information out on the local community channel. We'll be putting it on our Facebook and on the website, town's website as well, but we now have a drug disposal kiosk at the police station. It's not up and running yet because we have to be able to secure the lobby area. So within the next week or so, we'll be opening that up, so people will be able to come and drop off their unused prescription medications. So we'll have a location for them to drop that off there. I've already got a waiting list of people that are waiting for it to open up so they can come drop off their stuff. So the door handle has to be replaced before that can happen. And on top of that, we're also looking at video monitoring of the lobby area, just so it's kind of another, it's not required, but it's another safety feature as far as the drug disposal kiosk goes, to be able to monitor that in case somebody comes in and tries to steal it or something when we're not there, or tries to break into it. So
what's gonna happen with the drugs after you collect them?
Well, the procedure is, once you drop, it's kind of like a mailbox. I don't know if you've seen them or not. It's just a big, giant green box, a steel box. It's got a drawer in the door in the front of it. So you open the door, drop your prescription medication in there, close it. It drops down into a box, just a cardboard box. Once that cardboard box is full, there's actually two padlocks on the machine. So I have a key to one, Don has a key to another. Our sergeant has a key to the other lock. So neither one of us can open it without the other one being there. So when it gets to the point where it's full, we both have to unlock it. That box gets taped up, we both sign it. Once it's signed and packaged up, ready to go, then it gets stored in our evidence room. Every other month for Franklin County, every other month the Sheriff's Department comes down and does a collection for the whole county. And there's certain areas where they go. They don't go to every, I think there's 27 around the area now, so I don't think they go to each location. So more than likely our drop-off area will be Deerfield. So when the Sheriff's Department's coming for that day, we'll take our boxes, bring them to that location. They get weighed, they put it on a truck, they take it right from there. I believe it goes to West Springfield to the incinerator, and then they just throw it right into the incinerator once it's weighed. So there's no, the box never gets open once it gets sealed. So that's kind of the procedure that we have to follow, and that's set up through the district attorney's office. So we had to sign paperwork and an MOU saying that that's how we're going to handle the situation. So.
Are we going to advertise that, say, at the transfer station?
Yeah, they're in the district attorney's office is in the process of making us some posters. They said they're going to make us 5 posters to start off. We just got our box recently, and they weren't aware that we were actually getting a box. So they made posters for the entire county. We didn't make it onto that round of posters. So they're gonna make us our own posters that we can post around town. Next time that comes around where they make the posters for the county, then they'll put us on that as well. So it'll get posted around town. We'll probably put a poster here, put one at the transfer station, maybe at the post office or the library, something like that. The senior center already has one, and they're going to be aware that we have our own location because most of our seniors have been dropping it in Deerfield when they go to the senior center. So everybody will be aware of that. Like I said, we'll put it on the television channel, put it on the website, and so on and so forth. So hopefully it'll be well announced that we have it. And we're also in the process of putting up a Sharps container as well. We may be using the one from this building to put there along with it, because there's a lot of people that don't know what to do with their needles, diabetics and stuff that don't know how to dispose of their needles. So that'll be, give them a location to drop those off as well. So that'll be right next to the, right next to the disposal kiosk.
Okay, what else?
The paving is done at the station. They just finished the sidewalk going out back last week. So we've got our parking lot done and the sidewalk is done. So all of the paving is now done. The last two issues that I wanted to discuss are tasers and body cams. Tasers, we got an anonymous donation that came into the police station to purchase two tasers and all of the equipment and training necessary to go along with that. So Don and I, or Sergeant and I, are both already trained, so we just have to go through a short recertification process. But everybody else on our department, they don't have the training. The training is, it's a full 8-hour day that they have to go through for the training. Part of that training, they have to discharge two training cartridges from the taser. Those cost about $30 a piece. So we'd be looking at an 8-hour training day plus $60 per person as far as training goes to get those, the rest of the part-time officers up to speed. That probably won't happen with this year's budget because we don't have the money to cover that in this year's budget.
But I thought you said there's an anonymous get to take care of training as well.
Just for the initial two,
which
covers Don and I, and there'd be a third one that eventually we would get.
How many people were we talking about have trained on this?
That we have trained now?
No, we will train, because again, the anonymous gift is going to take care of two of your part-timers.
No, just Don and I.
Oh, I thought you were saying you guys were already trained.
We have the training, we just have to go through a short recertification, which is only going to take a couple of hours. It's not going to be a full 8-hour day.
See, that's what I'm confused about, Jim, and I apologize.
Yep. But
the anonymous donor gave two full training.
Well, they gave an amount of money that's going to cover two tasers. So just to explain a little bit deeper, the tasers themselves are about $950 each. Then we have to purchase the cartridges that we'll need to use for the training purposes. So we had to purchase those cartridges. Then we have to purchase cartridges for actual use, live deployment out on the road. So 6, 12. So we've had to get 12 different cartridges at $30 a piece, plus the tasers themselves. And the donation was $2,400. So.
Oh, so it's donating the hardware. It's not donating money to cover the cost of training the individuals in terms of their labor.
Correct. Not for the police officers, okay. not for sending them to training. That'll be something separate, probably worked into next year's
budget. I guess I was assuming that they were going to pay for their, that labor. Okay.
Yeah, they're expensive, and
okay.
Unfortunately, it doesn't cover.
Is this something that you want? Are tasers something that you want as a small town police department?
Well. I guess there's a couple of different ways of looking at it, but in a small town police department, I think it's even more valuable because we are alone. Sometimes our backup's 10 minutes away. We had an incident 2 years ago with an officer that was attacked. It took 6 minutes for the backup to arrive. It was one officer from Deerfield who had a taser, and then three or four state troopers that showed up. It took six people to subdue this individual along with the taser. And so the officer was fighting with this guy for six full minutes. So it's kind of, skin curling when you hear the tape of it, listening to them, fighting for 6 minutes on this. So these are situations, and there's been numerous situations. We've had one just within the last couple months where there was a person that got tased. Deerfield has tasers that they deploy. They actually tased an individual where the incident started in Whately. Our officer pursued him on foot, found him, and there was some threats made. The guy started to attack. Thankfully, he didn't get far enough to make contact with any of the officers because he was tased before he was able to do that, and they were able to subdue the individual. So there's a number of incidents that I could go over that I could cover just in Whately, and we back up Hatfield, and we back up Deerfield, and so it's a huge asset to us. And it doesn't replace any tools that we have, it just gives us another less than lethal option to kind of subdue somebody without causing any serious injuries. I mean, it's literally a 5 second, the prongs come out, once they come out, they make contact with the body and you're electrified for 5 seconds, and after that, and I've been through it myself, so I know after that 5 seconds, it's done and over with. And 99.9% of people comply, and if they've ever been tased before, 99.9% of those people, when they see the taser, they immediately comply because they don't want to have it happen again. So it's not really a problem, but the problem that we ran into was we were ready to deploy them, we were ready to put them out on the road, we had our policy in place. A couple weeks ago, Massachusetts, they changed the CMRs, some of the CMRs for the taser use to include some different things, training being some of that. But when that CMR changed, our policies now have to change, so everybody's kind of scrambling right now. If you already had a policy in place, you're okay until you can make modifications. If you didn't have a policy in place, which we didn't have them deployed, so we didn't have a policy, we didn't have them out on the road, so we now have to wait for the new policy to be released. Our Mass Chiefs Association are the ones that kind of give us the model policies, which we go by for all of our policies and procedures. So they're in the process of working at it, so it's probably going to be a couple weeks before we see anything in the way of a policy that we can implement. And once we get it, we still have to submit it to the Executive Office of Public Safety for them to approve it. So it's going to take a little bit of time. We were hoping to be up and running with it, but it's not.
What's your liability on using tasers?
The liability for?
If you cause harm to that person other than subduing them, do you have insurance to cover that?
It would be the same liability as anything else. It would be the same liabilities if somebody was injured when I was handcuffing them, or if I struck somebody with a baton and caused injury to them.
Or we
have to be able to justify that level of force that we're using. So if I can't justify that level of force that I'm using, then the town's not liable, I'm liable. So that's why we have training and policies and procedures, so make sure that people are staying within the use of force continuum, so they don't just use a taser for whatever reason. I mean, that's why they go through an 8-hour training class to review the use of force and show them when they can and can't deploy the taser.
But there could be medical conditions that a person has that you have no idea.
Absolutely. There's medical conditions people have now that when I hit them with a baton and their blood pressure goes up, they may have a heart attack. So we can't predict what medical conditions they have. All we can do is use the reasonable force necessary to gain compliance from that individual. I can't predict what level of force. There may be, mental health issues, or maybe a small child, a juvenile, somebody like that, or somebody with a predetermined medical condition. We may not use the taser on them. We may have to take other action. But so there are certain protocols that go along with that.
Body cameras.
So body cams, just to touch quickly, because I know I spoke with Jonathan about this before, and I think you would like to have more of an in-depth conversation about body cams. I just wanted to kind of give you a brief preview as far as body cams go, just to let the board know that I'm 100% in favor of body cams. I have no issue, no reservation about getting them, other than the legal issues that we're facing right now in Massachusetts, and the reasons why you don't see a lot of departments using body cams at this point is because of some of these legal things. Just to point out a couple of them, just to make it brief again, because I know Jonathan said he wanted a more in-depth report on this, but a couple of the issues that have come up as far as body cams go are privacy issues. Because if we're recording everything we do, we're recording everything that you're doing. If you have a medical call and we have to record that, we go to your house, there's a potential HIPAA violation if we give out a copy of that that recording to somebody, because it would fall under public records law. And right now there's nothing really defining what we can and can't give as far as public records go. So essentially we'd have to give all of the information that we have, which could invade on your privacy or your medical conditions. So privacy issues, wiretapping statute. There was a recent change to the wiretapping statute, which allowed anybody to record a police officer in a public area, but it didn't allow police officers to record or secretly record anybody in a public area. So the issues that come up as far as wiretapping statute is we have to notify everybody that they're being recorded. If something happens, you know, officer's fighting with somebody, you run up on the scene, you know, I'm not going to be jumping in and making sure I warn them. You know, you may not have the, you know, the mindset to tell them, hey, you're being recorded before you jump into the pile to help subdue them. So there could be potential issues as far as the wiretapping statute where you're recording them against their will. So we wouldn't be able to use that as evidence, and they could in turn sue us for recording them. So there may be some issues there. Victims of crimes. When we go to a domestic, for example, we have to interview the suspect and the victim. We have to interview both parties to determine who's the victim, who's the suspect. If we're interviewing the victim, again, that falls back to now we've recorded them because public information, so will we have to release, you know, recordings of victim statements in an incident where they've been abused by somebody else. So those haven't been worked out yet as well. And record retention issues, I don't know that it's gonna be as big of an issue for our department as it is for much larger departments. For our department, I could see us having three, possibly four body cams, which we would then in turn sign out to officers to be a procedure for doing that. So if we had three or four body cams, which are roughly $1,000 a piece, some of them are a little bit less expensive, everything we do, we have to record. So in turn, we have to keep that. So there's record retention laws. We now have to have a place to store that, those videos, the video recordings. So every call that we go to that has to be recorded, we now have to save that. And there hasn't been anything defined yet as to how long we have to save certain investigations as far as cameras go. So some of them we have to save indefinitely. So that's kind of another issue. We'd have to have some sort of server or some sort of computer with enough storage to store high definition data on for every incident that we get involved with. So there are some concerns behind it, but again, I support it wholeheartedly. I think it helps the public, and I think it helps the police altogether. I've seen statistics where false claims against police have gone down. I've seen statistics where use of force, you know, excessive use of force issues have gone down when body cams are deployed because everybody knows they're being recorded now. So I've seen it on both sides. So I think there's a benefit to both of them. There's also the concern of, do we just look at body cams, or do we do body cams and cruiser cams? And do we record everything in the station? If we're going to record on a body cam, you know, we might as well record everything else. And, you know, cameras, we're looking at putting cameras in the station now. Two cameras to set up in the station right now is, I got a quote for $2,400 just to put two cameras in our police station with the recording device. Each additional camera that we put in would be about $400 just for the camera. So you're looking at thousands of dollars worth of cameras and recording devices and storage devices. So it is an expensive proposition.
There are some
grants, and I talked with Brian, and there's some things that are out there that we're looking at if this does move forward as far as the equipment goes, as far as training goes. Everything's got training to go along with it. So there are some factors that have to be seriously looked at. I can't really speak to how it's been working for other departments. I've talked with them. I know some of the guys in Hatfield, they love them. They wouldn't give them up if they had to. But again, those other issues that I discussed haven't been addressed really across the state.
Would you be opposed to having some people who have some of the towns like Hatfield that have some experience with this coming in to talk with us, or at least having Brian reach out to them to get the pros and cons?
Yeah, absolutely not. I've already talked to the lieutenant over there. He's a big proponent of it. He's the one responsible for all of the
data. And how they've dealt with some of the issues that you brought up here.
Yep. And I talked with him, and he said he'd be more than happy to come in and talk with you guys, because looking for, you know, a third party to come in and discuss it, somebody that has some experience with it, he'd be more than happy to come in and discuss it with you guys.
I think it's something we should definitely look into. I'm not saying we should do it, but we should absolutely look at the pros and cons.
Yeah, and like I said, I have no reservations about even going out and buying them, and it's just those other things that have been addressed.
Okay, one final thing, not related to this. What's the decision to paint the decals on the new cruiser?
The final decision has been to leave it the way it is now, leave it unmarked. There's a couple of reasons. I guess the number one reason, if there's really a number one reason, but number one reason, the funding. We don't have the funding to do it right now. It'd probably be about $900, $900 to $1,000 to get it lettered, if we were to get it lettered. The second, or 1A, if you want to call it that, would be with the new juvenile laws that I touched on a little bit earlier. There are some issues with transporting juveniles under arrest or in custody in marked police cruisers. So that would give us an opportunity to be able to transport a juvenile if we had to, because there used to be a grant where if we arrested a juvenile, we could call. Greenfield had a van. They would come down and pick them up and transport them. They no longer have that grant, so we're kind of stuck on our own to transport if we had to.
How often does that happen? Or does that happen?
I can tell you it doesn't happen too often unless it's a very serious crime, because the way police officers in general, I think, look at juvenile issues is that's a big thing, to actually take somebody into custody, arrest them, put them in jail, and doing that to a juvenile, it's a very serious thing. So we kind of weigh that with our discretion, and usually we issue summons. We don't arrest juveniles very often because of that. We don't want to put them through all of that, unless it's a serious crime. But there have been times where, you know, it's, you know, 16, 15, 16 year old that's beating up his mother or gets in a fight with his father or something like that, and we have no choice but to deal with it.
Yeah. So what else, other reasons you said?
So those are the top two reasons.
Okay.
I've heard, we kind of did an unofficial poll on Facebook. People have said leave it unmarked. They like it unmarked. People have said go with a whole new letter scheme. Some people have said just put hash marks on it. So we've gotten so many different things, and it all balanced out to where, I mean, again, it wasn't an official, you know, a survey that went out, but, you know, the general consensus that we got was that nobody really had any strong feelings to say, yeah, we have to absolutely get it lettered. I think it's going to be beneficial to us to not letter it, whether it's used as a traffic car and it's more incognito than a fully marked car. So there's some other reasons to keep it unmarked.
Okay.
So those are just the two.
You guys are doing good stuff. I've heard some good, interesting stories about you taking down the bad guys lately. So
it's an interesting summer.
Are you retiring on one of the other ones?
The Chevy that it replaced, I guess you could call it semi-retired.
Yeah.
We're using it for details. If there's a detail out on 5 and 10, I've kind of mandated, because 5 and 10 being a, you know, state highway and more of a traffic concern, I've mandated that if we have a detail out on 5 and 10, that we'll have a cruiser out there as well. So the cruiser will be used for details. Or, you know, if an officer has to go down to the academy for in-service training or something like that, or to a class, they could take that car instead of putting mileage on another.
So
you're going to
maintain the three?
Yes.
The three you're going to maintain?
Correct. Yeah. And the Chevy, the limited use that'll get, we're not going to be putting tires on it every year. We're not going to be getting oil changes on it every month. You know, most of the stuff we could probably kind of take care of ourselves. If it's a, you know, something minor, a light bulb out, you know, we're not going to bring it in for
the Swamp Road service.
Yeah. Oh, that was the other thing I was going to talk.
Speaking of Swamp Road, and the radar board, not on Swamp Road, but it has been on Chestnut Plain and on Long Plain. And on Chestnut Plain, it was a major difference in the speed of the traffic.
Sure.
So, but I don't know, I don't get around the whole town. I don't know if it's been up anywhere else.
Yes, you do.
Well, I do, and I haven't seen it.
That was my next, the next thing that I was going to say.
Okay, well, if you've got it.
It's going up in front of your house tomorrow.
No, well, and that's actually what I was going for, but I do like that.
Eight mil was next on the list.
I did offer to power it myself. I have no problem, because it's a battery issue.
It's solar anyway.
It should be.
It should be. It's not. It's a two-day charge, as I understand.
It should be solar, anyway.
My only request was, or for discussion, was if we couldn't make it some sort of policy where it goes out 2 days a week, which would be the battery life, I think.
Mm-hmm. I think
it does a great job.
I think it's a deterrent. I don't want to be the town that just runs around issuing tickets. I want to be a town where it's a deterrent so people are smart.
Yeah, and I agree. But I wanted to run it by Jim and see if he had a problem with that. Or
until you exhaust the battery budget.
It is.
Well, let's get
just to be honest, it is a little bit difficult. It is a little bit difficult
little,
to transport it around.
A little quarter kW, eighth of a kW thing is going to power it.
Yeah.
All right.
It was almost $3,000 just for that.
Yeah.
So.
No, I think that's right.
Okay, let's move on.
You're done.
You're done.
Sure.
Okay. I didn't mean to cut you off. Okay.
No, I think he needs to be cut off. We're done.
Okay. We have somebody here. Is a public comment? You.
I'm just here. I'm Geneva Peterson. My husband and I own Hitchcock Brewery.
Okay.
Should we go to that so she doesn't have to sit through this misery anymore?
Okay, we can go to that item. It's on there. On the agenda, okay.
Let me find it here. So,
is it in here?
Yeah, there's a letter from.
Yes.
Here it is. How can I summarize this? Correct me if I'm wrong or if they want anything.
I have a lot of stuff.
Hitchcock Brewing Company has something called a farm brewer license to brew alcohol. And as part of that license, this is a state license that's issued by the ABCC. As part of that license, it allows Hitchcock to sell wholesale and to also sell retail for off-site consumption. There was some uncertainty in the law as to whether that would enable an establishment or allow an establishment to do a tasting room, so to allow samples on the premise. And the ABCC issued an advisory, it was in 2013, which said that the local licensing authority needs to make a determination that the tasting room, the activities of the tasting room, so the offering of the samples, does not constitute a sale of alcohol. Now this really relates back to a technicality in the law, which says that the offering of alcohol at a commercial establishment, is presumed to be a sale. So there's this presumption in the law back from how many hundreds of years ago. So what they're asking for here is a request for determination from the select board that the operation of their tasting room does not constitute a sale of alcohol. So there's something called a farmer series pouring permit. And that would allow Hitchcock Brewing, which they haven't applied for, that would allow them for the sale of alcohol for on-site consumption. But that's not what they're doing. They're providing free samples. Are they providing samples of their beer?
Right, so they're not becoming a bar.
Right.
Okay, but you said the advisory pertained to commercial establishments. Are they considered a commercial?
Yes.
Because they sell beer for takeout purposes,
yes.
For lack of a better definition.
Yeah. It is a farm brewery, so they're a commercial establishment.
Correct me if I'm wrong, and again, by definition, every brewery is kind of a farm brewery because you have to grow stuff to make the beer. Isn't that fair?
You don't have to grow it on
you
your own site,
though.
No, you don't, it has to be grown somewhere.
Somewhere, yes. Farm, yeah.
Yeah.
So the definition of farm brewer is that a certain percentage of the of the input into the beer is grown on site.
On site.
Or grown on the premises, right?
I actually don't believe that's correct.
No, there's no percentage?
The farm brewer's license is determined by how much beer you produce in a given year. So the licenses are based on production. There are some statutes in the Mass Law that recommend you use a certain percentage of product that you grow that is from Massachusetts, was produced in Massachusetts.
So, in theory, you wouldn't have to produce any of the ingredients. You wouldn't have to grow any of the ingredients to qualify.
Correct.
So, what would prevent me from doing that?
Nothing. Well, there's certain regulations.
Well, sure, but if I go through those processes, and I'm not a farmer.
Right.
And I'm not saying it is, but I struggle. I isn't that kind of a loophole?
It's the way the regulations are.
Right, I get that. Right. I mean, it's so any of us could become.
I think it's under a certain quantity.
Under
a certain quantity.
That's the case.
And do you know what that quantity is?
I don't have the regulations in front of me.
Under the certain quantity of total sales, in terms of
maybe
it's
volume.
It's amount of gallons.
I think it's volume.
Volume, right, right. Not receipts.
Correct.
So I guess my last question would be: you're assuming, however, you're hoping. It's a marketing tactic. That if, I'm going to pick on Dan, because Dan comes to all of our meetings. If Dan is thirsty, and you're hoping, and comes to sample beer, you're hoping that he comes to actually sample it and then buy it.
You hope.
Yes.
It's not mandatory.
It's not mandatory. Okay, but how often is Dan going to be allowed to come sample the beer without ever buying it before you say, wait a second, Dan, stop?
When the keg runs dry.
Well, that's sort of my question. I'm not asking these questions because I want to be against this. I'm sort of trying to figure out what, at some point, because it's marketing, obviously. That's why you have a sampling, because you want people to buy your product, pick up the six pack, I don't know how you sell it. And take it to their home, then put it in their refrigerator or what have you. And maybe if you sell casks, they can put it in their home tap. I don't know. But at some point, someone's going to say to Dan, Dan, don't come back. You got it.
We'll have to deal with that situation when that comes up because there's not anything that dictates what you do or say or how you approach that situation. So it depends on the business owner. If you want to let him come in and have endless samples and not purchase
them. Shame on you.
Right.
As a business owner, because I'm losing money.
Right, exactly. So, but I guess my question, it seems like an incredibly nebulous gray area. So you are kind of assuming a sale. Otherwise, you're going to stop allowing the sample.
You're assuming a sale for off-premise.
Right.
Right. The sale for off-premise consumption is okay. It's when it's the sale for on-premise consumption is when you need to get that additional pouring series permit.
But they're not. Yeah, I mean, it's a nebulous gray here.
It's a distinction that the law makes between off-site and on-site consumption.
The purpose of the approval by the local board is to legally say to the ABCC that you've looked into this and that we are not in any way, spoken or unspoken, charging people
right.
for that tasting. Because there are some situations that have come up in Mass, and there are also different laws in different states where some of the things are allowed in other states that aren't allowed here. In some states, you can say tastings are free, but you have to pay $5 for that glass to drink out of.
Do you do that?
We do not.
Do you charge for parking?
We do not charge for anything except the growlers you take out in your hand.
Full of beer.
Or if you buy a t-shirt.
Or, right.
Or buy a...
There's no, you don't have to spend a dime.
You don't have to take a tour, you don't have to pay for parking, you don't have to pay for a tasting glass. So that's why this regulation came into effect.
Got it, okay.
Because some establishments were charging those types of things to help cover their costs of the volume of beer that they lose in those samples. And other states actually allow those things to happen. All right, you walk through the door, you have to pay $5 for a tour, and then you can have free samples, and then you can, if you choose to buy stuff to take home. So it's more a term, it's a letter asking for you to determine and file with the state that we are in no way charging for these tastings, which are actually allowed by the ABCC.
Right. So if I go there, I'm not charged a dime until I buy a growler.
Right. Even if you buy a growler.
If I buy, right. I understand.
For offsite.
I mean, that's not.
For offsite, right. I can't open the.
Cannot open the growler and drink it.
We don't even convey that, okay, you had your taste of every beer we have now. Which growler would you like to take home? That's not conveyed at all either. People say, I'm all set. Thank you.
I'm sampling for my Christmas gifts?
Yeah.
Right.
So we have to rotate.
Okay.
Do spot checks.
It's kind of a formality to file the approval or disapproval with ABCC.
So this is really asking for a pourer's permit? Is that
No.
No, this is asking for a determination from the Board of Selectmen that the operation of their tasting room does not constitute a sale of alcohol.
I buy that.
In our circumstances.
In the circumstances set forth in the letter.
Now, if they change, and I'm fine with it, but if they change that policy, what's the? I mean, if all of a sudden, you know, we issue this,
it's just a termination letter.
Termination letter.
Yeah.
And I'm being extreme here, so forgive me. Look, honey. We got a determination letter. Now let's change the policies. What's to prevent that?
It's an open door. We can be visited by the TTB, the ABCC, or any members.
So there is some kind of oversight.
It's what you choose to do.
Or be visited by the licensing. Well, the licensing authority.
In our regulations from the state and from the TTB, we have to have open door policy. People can come in. You don't have to know who they are. They can ask for records at any time. They can just observe what happens in the establishment. So that would be up to you. And we have nothing to hide, so.
But we could, we don't have to state that tonight. It's just part of what we do.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do abutters have to be notified that there's going to be a change of use?
If we go for a pouring permit, you mean?
Yeah.
Yes.
Right. That's the thing that I was confused about, is that this is a commercial enterprise. You're selling beer.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it's by growler. That's how you sell it.
And we sell it by keg.
And you sell it by keg. I prefer the word cask, but that's okay. And obviously, Christian Lane is zoned residential.
We're actually zoned, well, we're in an agricultural zone.
Agricultural zone, right. Agricultural residential, right. But this is a commercial enterprise. I mean, you're selling.
It's actually considered a farm stand, so it's agriculture.
It comes under agriculture.
Right, but again, you don't have to grow any of it.
We have a hop yard in the backyard.
But you don't have to.
You don't have to.
That's what I...
Your wheels are turning, aren't they?
Yeah, I mean,
you're going to have a little stand up there on.
No. Well, but I guess what's to prevent that? I mean, it's sort of like that. I'm not zoned commercial, but what's to prevent anyone from Whately from doing this?
But that's not the issue.
I get it. But I'm taking advantage of the.
Those are issues for me to, you know.
But I mean, I'm fine with this, but it's just. Yeah.
It's what the ABCC is trying to help all the small businesses.
I'm not against that, Paul. I'm just saying that
was developed involved as well to help agriculture.
I guess it's ABC has determined that, and they're the ones living with the fallout from the...
And if you were growing it, I'd say, yeah, I get that. But if it's being grown from the barley fields of Colorado...
No, it's going to be in mass.
In mass.
There'd be barley fields in Hadley.
It has to be in Massachusetts.
Okay.
No, they recommend that you get as much.
See, this is the...
Massachusetts doesn't.
Again, I'm asking this, not that I'm opposed.
There was a law back in 08 that Massachusetts put in that all craft breweries in Massachusetts had to have, I don't know, say it was 50% of their product come from Mass. That law didn't last long.
That law didn't last long.
Because the brewers all said, no, Mass doesn't produce enough of those ingredients. Because you can't count the law.
I'm fine with this, I'm just...
Okay, all right. Jonathan, should... We wait to hear what...
No.
I've heard that some people in town are objecting to your business, and it's coming before the planning board, whether zoning regulations are coming into play, is what you have. Has you had any decision from the zoning board, planning board? What's happening with the planning board on this?
We haven't heard anything from the planning board.
You haven't heard anything?
As far as I understand, they have all the approvals that are required from the building inspector and from the Board of Health. Is that correct?
Correct. And we also consulted with the zoning board when we started.
Okay, so you're not waiting for anything or have no notice to appear before planning board or zoning board on this? Okay. And you haven't heard anything more?
I know that there's been...
We had a letter written by an individual.
I know that there's been discussions about that.
Yeah.
But as of today, I believe they've required... I checked with building inspector and FERCOG and asked if they had all the required permits, certificate of occupancy for the tasting room, and from there, and it's... They've been issued.
Is the letter from an abutter, or is the letter from a person across town? I mean, it's public document.
It was from an abutter and somebody on the planning board. I could say that.
Well, it's a public document, so yeah. It's not like it's a private...
No.
You can't make a private letter.
No, but it was from an abutter where they saw the sign up for your tasting room. Yeah. And they were questioning whether you had all the permits. And
we clearly have all the permits. We're not concerned about that.
Some of the zoning requirements for shared driveways and use of the...
And do you think they abut?
Not directly.
Yeah, I don't think.
But you don't have to be direct to be
abut. No, I understand, but I don't
on the street.
On the street.
But you know what? I don't want to talk about if we're not going to make the person public, I don't want to talk about the abutter because it's public information.
The issue tonight is very narrow.
Right. Based upon this, we have no reason to not allow this letter of determination, in my opinion. As crazy as I think some of this is, because the law just seems different, we have no reason to not issue this letter of determination. That's my opinion. I don't know how you feel, but... And if you don't agree, then we have to wait
for
the call.
So I'll remind you, what you're voting on is whether our tastings constitute a sale.
Right.
Okay.
You're not voting on whether you think we have all the permits, or whether you think it's a good thing or a bad thing for the neighborhood. You're voting on whether our tastings constitute a sale.
Okay, well then I'll agree with that.
Yeah, I make a motion.
Second.
All right.
Okay.
Great. So I'll pull together that letter and send it off.
Okay, great.
And I apologize for putting,
Right. No, you know, we've heard that there's been letters.
And I hadn't heard that.
We're going to face, concerned people in the town and in the neighborhood. But we also know that we think this is good for the community. We are using our own hops. We are going to use as much agricultural crops from Whately as well as neighboring towns as we can, and we already have. We've used Norris raspberries, we've used Long Plain squash, pumpkin. It's our backyard too. Our house is at the front of the road. the breweries at the back, middle of the property, with the hop yard right there. We don't want to have chaos in our area, in our backyard. We have made sure that we followed all, got all the permits and permissions and everything like that along the way.
I just wish the legislation was more in tune with what you guys were already doing as opposed to letting Fred do it.
Right, but you can't change what's there.
Right now, right, okay.
Okay.
We're good.
Yep.
Anything else on it? Okay.
Thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you for asking.
How can we whip through a lot of this, Brent? Because we are pushing, not that, I know Fred's in charge, but.
Community compact is the next.
Community compact.
Business.
Board voted on two items for the community compact in June. By the time we went to the community compact website, they had taken down the application for FY16. They put up the application for FY17 for the community compact. But what the application requires is that we select up to three best practices. And you have the sheet in your packet. And what we need to select, we can't just select the headings. Last time we selected the headings. The last time we selected, we're going to do financial best practices. We're going to do...
Right.
We need to actually select a specific activity.
Now, do they have to be forward or can it already be in existence?
It needs to be looking forward.
So we can't say we're already a green community?
We can't say we're already what?
A green community.
Right.
We can't use that as one of our...
Right.
Because we're just so far ahead of the curve. Okay.
Brian, do you want to say what you have recommended?
I mean, items for consideration would be, so we're selecting three. And part of these are in relation to two grants that are going to come through the Community Compact Program. One is an IT grant, an information technology grant, and one is a regionalization grant. So things for your consideration would be the regionalization shared services activity. So are we sick of regionalization yet?
Do we really want to discuss that tonight?
Probably not a good time to bring that up.
Besides shared services, forget the regionalization.
But
of course, it doesn't say who we have to regionalize with. We can regionalize with Hatfield, Sunderland. Oh, never mind, I'm sorry.
You can regionalize with anybody. But as you probably know, there's a lot of state resources going towards those types of things. So you can think about that. Information technology best practices.
I like that.
We need some help with IT. IT work. What I would recommend is 1, 2, 3, 4.
Where is that?
Page 6 of 9 on that sheet.
Too many pages.
They have a lot of best practices.
Competitiveness, urban renewal planning, IT strategic planning, transparency, where?
I would suggest the fourth one down, develop a comprehensive IT strategy.
Focus on better aligning technology investment, short and long term organization. Yeah.
And they do have a IT grant that's going to come out in March. And then the third one for your consideration would be the under financial management best practices, the first one. That's page 4 of 9. Best practices, the first one, establish a budget document that details all revenue expenditures, narrative describing priorities and challenges, offers clear and transparent communication of financial policies to residents and businesses.
Shouldn't be doing that. I mean, do the three items we choose limit what we can use community compact resources for? You're going to say yes.
I'm going to say if it's in the same category, I think we could probably get away with it. But if it's in different, if it's in completely different categories, I think it would be more difficult to make the argument.
So is this? Maybe I'm missing something there where you said, whatever we pick here, we have a chance to get special funding for that, implement that activity?
We could get assistance.
Assistance.
Assistance from the state, yeah. And there are two grant programs that are coming up. One is a regionalization grant, and then the other one is an information technology grant, which would pay up to $200,000 of capital costs for IT equipment.
Okay, there's, I guess, one other one I thought, I didn't look at every one of these, but Underwater resources management. We're looking at combining the two water agencies, department and district here.
Yep.
Manage water system assets. Going to condition infrastructure and plan maintenance and rehab. I mean, we are talking, the two departments are talking, and we are moving forward, Jonathan, slowly, but we are looking at that. Is that something we could get money for?
Possibly.
Yeah, because that's going to be a big ticket item. And it's going to be, and there's the politics around that.
It could be, depending how, which way we go on that, but yeah.
And the politics around it are not going to be pretty, potentially.
No. I don't know, would that help us any more than what you picked? I just...
The financial thing doesn't excite me.
Yeah.
But...
We need it.
Well, we need a lot of things.
I know, but we really...
But isn't Paul doing some of that already?
Not the kind of overhaul that we...
No, he's talking about for the stuff that... That the treasurer does and the collector does and all that kind of stuff.
Okay, all of that, okay.
I'm talking about the whole budget, putting the budget together in a more transparent manner.
I mean...
And to have some kind of uniformity with that.
Yeah.
We can't pick more than three?
Three.
I mean, because I think about it. Think about, we have an old town dump sitting there doing nothing. And there's a grounds field thing there. I mean, there's so many things in this list that are plausible projects that would either save the town money or make it more efficient or make it a more appealing and attractive place to live, do business in, live, work, and play. It's hard to pick three, but I would agree with Fred that the water thing may be and if You guys have to run the town on a daily basis. Think the financial management thing's more important. Well, pick your poison. Which of the two that you mentioned don't
make
the
cut? Well, that would be three, right? You did water, financial management, and
IT.
But you picked that there was another one that Brian...
Well, we talked about regionalization. But
oh, yeah. No,
I'm...
Because that's working out so well for us these days.
Right.
So what if we did IT, financial, and...
Water.
Fine.
Okay.
As much as it pains me not to do stuff on climate and energy. Because there are some farmers around here who had a tough summer because we didn't have any rain. And if anyone thinks that's not related to climate change, their heads are in the sand.
So financial management will do the best practice, establish a budget, the first best practice. IT will do the one I talked about, the comprehensive IT strategy.
Yeah.
And then the other will be water resource management, manage water assets.
All right. Yeah. Okay.
Yes. And we'll try to make that application tomorrow, so that way we're in line, we're in queue for when Keith wants to apply for the small bridge.
Yeah, it's an easy application, so it's...
Yeah.
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 Okay.
Okay.
Are they all 200,000? Excuse me, Fred. Brian?
What's up?
Are they all 200,000? You said the IT was 200,000.
Up to 200,000.
For any of those that you mentioned?
No, this is very specific for the IT. There's a separate IT grant program.
Gotcha.
I don't think any town came close to getting a $200,000 award last year.
Okay. Up to.
It's probably not going to happen again this year, considering the revenue projections.
Okay, town administrator's performance evaluation.
Comcast contract?
So the comp... I talked to Fred about this before. The Comcast contract is about... It's not finalized. It's about 98% done. I have most of the boilerplate of the contract, but we're waiting on gross revenue figures.
And when that contract is signed, then we can start doing the drops here in here and stuff like that?
Yeah.
It's supposed to be in the contract. I don't know if you've seen it yet, Brian.
Okay.
Yes, it should be in there. I want to double check the language, but it talks about...
98%, does that mean the finish line really is within sight, or is that 2% going to be painful?
I hope it should be within sight. I can tell you what they're hung up on, and it is a legal technicality that they're hung up on, but that does affect the gross revenue or Comcast's ability to how it accounts for the advertising dollars that our gross revenues based upon.
Okay.
Okay, moving on. Performance evaluation for Brian here is 90 days is up. And
then 90 days, well.
And you're still here.
90 more days, more than 90 days.
Okay. And we were all supposed to fill out the evaluation forms. I did one and sent it to Mary Ellen. And
yep.
I sent one to Mary Ellen, thought she was going to get a virus, so she didn't know in mind.
Well, it was red.
What?
The message was red. It said,
do you know how many emails I send on a daily basis with attachments?
Well, this one said it would harm my computer, talking about IT issues.
Okay. I sent it again.
Okay, I'll look. Okay.
So we need to...
And if it happens again, I'll resave it.
Okay.
Okay. And I'll send it in PDF.
Okay.
So we need to act on them. Well, decide it. I guess we can look at the evaluations, what, next time you'll put them together?
Yeah, so we'll compile them for next time.
And do we need to make a determination today as to whether you're doing
it would be helpful.
Acceptable work?
Well, I can say all three were more than satisfactory.
You didn't read mine.
I did read yours, I just didn't open it up.
How is that possible?
I couldn't open it up to print it or do anything with it.
Could you preview it?
I could preview it.
Oh, you could preview it?
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so we all agreed that it was more than satisfactory.
More than satisfactory and exceeds expectations in many categories.
That he's turned water into wine. And
yes.
Okay, so we can approve that.
I don't want to end it that way, though.
Acceptable 90-day determination and increase the salary amount to
whatever we decided upon.
Okay, effective.
Effective, you name the date.
Well, when is 90
days? When is 90 days?
90 days is up.
928.
Then effective 920.
Whatever
9
is. Yeah.
8, whatever.
Okay.
Yeah, that's right after.
As long as he's not going to apply for the job in Southampton.
Yeah. Or Deerfield.
He's not crazy enough to do that.
We've had that discussion.
He lives in Southampton.
I am not crazy.
I know the story.
This is, I don't be on camera, so.
I know. I shouldn't say
it. Okay. Potential special town meeting topics. I guess I brought this up at the last meeting, that they have a special information session in conjunction with our special town meeting.
On.
And I had three or four items that people are, some are willing so far to present and open up for comment discussion. The water department district merger was one item. The town hall renovation, we should get some final plans and estimates from the architect working on that right now. And that kind of fits in with our schedule for completing the project and for meeting due dates for CPA funding and other funding. So that falls into their schedule, okay. That would be two. The complete streets, not complete streets. The Conway School of Design, what came out of that. So far, the meetings have been in the center of town. I realize public meetings, but most people attending are from the center of town, and I think the rest of the town should be aware of what's being considered up there, especially if they're going to be funding some improvements. So just to hear comments and to see where we go, I guess, from the results of that. We could do complete streets. I don't know where we would stand on that, whether enough would be done.
Fred, who's going to staff these information booths?
Well, my idea was people from each of these areas would make some kind of presentation, 10, 15 minutes, and then open up for discussion. We would do three or four of them, but I mean, first one would talk to make a presentation, however they wanted, 10, 15 minutes, and then open up for discussion, maybe for 15 more minutes. So that would take up the first half hour. Then the second one would talk for 10, 15 minutes, have some discussion, go to the third one, same format, and the fourth if we need it. And then at the end, anybody has anything else they want to comment on, talk about, and have these people also stay after the meeting if people want to come directly to them and say something, comments if they want.
So you're asking for 2 hours on top of the special town meeting.
And I'm not sure people are going to, yeah, I'm not sure people are going to give.
Well, we can limit it to...
2 hours. Remember when we did...
Three.
Remember when we had...
Town Hall.
What's that?
Town Hall thing.
No, I'm thinking about the master plan. We had the different stations set up at the elementary school.
Yeah.
And it was a very effective use of time because people could go to the section of the master plan that they were interested in. And they could have conversations with the person who was most knowledgeable about that subject matter, about open space. And I don't remember what the specific items on that master plan revision was or were. But I just wonder whether that makes more sense so that you have the four areas and you set it up for, you know, 45 minutes before the town meeting starts, and then people can show up, they can look at the different things, they can ask their questions, and then they can come to town meeting, because I just don't think you're gonna get people to give 2 hours.
Well, or limit it to, I don't know, 20 minutes for each topic instead of half hour. It's still, you could still do the individual booths or tables like you're saying, either before or after, but I'm just thinking some kind of presentation to the whole group. I guess my purpose is to, I guess, inform as many people in town about these major activities as we can.
Right, and I don't disagree with that.
And if you set up, say, four booths for people to come and talk, I mean, you're kind of, you're limiting.
Fred's right, you're going to have something during the general session to give validity to to all of the advertising that you're going to do prior. But what you said, having those stations, I think creates that interest level coming into the meeting. It's addressed, and maybe even afterwards, having those stations there.
Still there.
Yeah, yeah.
But even giving 20 minutes per subject, I think it's too long. You're going to lose people.
Well, but something.
Something. Fine, but I just want to be as efficient as possible with people's time.
Yeah.
The key would be for the presenters to keep it tight.
Yeah.
You know, 10 minutes on a presentation, open it to questions, and move on.
At most 10 minutes, because I think you're going to have more time devoted to five in the question and answer.
No, I understand, but I'm just saying, we got to emphasize to the presenters.
Then I would make it 5 minutes and then open it up to Q&A.
Okay.
Because you will lose people. You just just will.
Okay, so I guess we need to decide how many and what subjects to present, and then I guess to inform these people. I guess I work with Brian to send out something to inform them of what we're doing, so it gives them advance notice to prepare if they need to. We'll advertise somewhere in the paper or put these signs out on the street, information meeting and special town meeting. I think if we do it in conjunction, you're going to get more probably at special town meeting, and hopefully then people will stay and listen to the second half of the meeting.
Well, do you want to look at the potential warrants and items so you see what we'll be discussing and potentially how long?
So this memorandum right here is just a list of the potential topics for a fall special town meeting.
Before Frontier.
Before Frontier?
Yeah, one page before, yeah. Well, two pages.
One more.
One more.
There you go.
Okay.
Those are all things that are kicking around there. This is just preliminary. I want you to just start thinking about special town meeting in the fall, maybe in November.
What category for the CPA can do at the town hall? Historic preservation?
Yeah.
I believe it's historic preservation.
Yeah. Okay.
So we have the new vault topic, town office, USDA loan payoff. I wanted to talk to you about the anticipated school transportation costs here.
Does this mean the new vault is $128,000 and we're dividing up the cash where we're getting it from?
I believe so.
Yeah. Half CPA and half appropriation.
That's the request, yeah.
How much is in free cash right now?
Free cash isn't certified.
It's not certified. It's there. It's at the DOR right now.
Do you get a number?
Not yet.
What's your guess?
I have no idea.
With or without the cell tower?
Don't confuse things.
Well, it'll be in there, okay, so.
It'll be in there.
It will be in there. Right, so with that, I want the net. I don't want the feeding frenzy to start already. You laugh. Who predicted it?
Wait, I don't have my list out yet.
So number four, let's talk about number four real quick if we can. The anticipated school transportation costs. We received notice from the school district that there was what's considered a homeless student that had moved into Whately. So it's a child without a permanent home. And under, it's actually the, I believe it said No Child Left Behind Act. It was cited to me as the McKinney-Vento law that the district where the child without a permanent home is staying is responsible for 50% of the school transportation costs. And the student attends Smith Vocational High School. But those are costs that were not anticipated in the budget.
Where does this come from, school committee?
This comes from the school district.
Yeah, I mean, that's nothing new. We've faced that before.
Yeah, right. So that's just an anticipated cost of plan four. We have the housing trust that's been spoken about before. I wanted to just touch quickly on how we want to proceed with the property that's adjacent to the school. That's adjacent to the elementary school, yeah. The Sanderson property. What steps do you want me to take, if any? I mean, in order to purchase the property, we're going to need an appraisal. We want to see what the school committee says first.
I think we'll wait to see what the school committee says first.
I'd recommend you give them the okay for the appraisal pending the school committee's decision so that you don't have to wait for another meeting on that. You could potentially pull this off by a special town meeting.
Yeah. We need an appraisal before we can purchase. Yeah. And you're going to need that appraisal to know what dollar value you're putting there for the special town meeting.
If we were to buy it at a price.
Is that going to come out of the school's budget?
If
the appraisal?
We buy it at a price five.
No, it's going to come out of the towns.
Why? I mean,
because we own the school.
The school's making the request, however, Dan.
Because we pushed them to make the request.
Who's we?
What are you guys waiting for? A recommendation from the school.
Yes, a recommendation from the school.
We asked the school to make a recommendation.
The school came to us too because they wanted to buy the property. They're the ones who initiated the conversation.
Right. Okay, so let's say it comes out of the school budget.
I mean, it's all
either
hard.
Way,
it's all the same.
Money. So why are we splitting hairs?
What we say for free cash?
I just think we should give them the okay for the appraisal if the school makes a recommendation. Okay. So you don't have to wait. We don't make the meeting, we don't make it.
Yeah, I mean, you go for the spring. I mean, it's no big deal. I mean,
no, but you're going to hear about snow fences being put up and et cetera, because there's the school committee's concerned about whatever, snow blowing into the parking lot and all, so the longer we wait, the more we're going to throw at that piece.
Okay, well, I guess we can wait for school board approval. The recommendation, and then I guess in the meantime you can make contacts with some appraisers to see, start the process, see what they charge, and
well, we can find out what they charge, right?
And how soon turnaround time we can get from them.
Hey, do you agree with that, Jonathan?
What's that?
Do you agree with what Fred said?
Okay, so that would be on there. Okay, go ahead.
Yep, 7 and 8 talk. About the charitable donation of the fire truck and the trailer. There's a request from the water department to transfer money. This is number 9. And then we have a request from, and there's a letter in your packet, from the superintendent to repurpose around what's remaining of $10,000 that was allocated in 2004, which was originally, its original purpose was to repair the school district's central office building. They're asking the towns place a warrant article at a special town meeting to repurpose those funds to pay for the move.
Totaling $39,000, right?
I haven't seen a final figure.
I think it's a total of $39,000. Ken must be Whately's percentage.
Well, but that was, Ken was to make repairs back in 2004.
And they've spent the difference on, presumably on repairs to the central district office.
I guess my concern is we should know what the total amount is and whether we're paying our fair share, whether it's by the school, by the formula set up for the four towns or divided by four equally. This doesn't tell us anything.
I believe there was $39,000 left from the 2004. All four towns put in, I can't remember the amount, let's say $100,000. For some reason, even though they had all kind of problems with the building, they never used the $39,000 from 2004. So now they want to take that money, instead of keeping the building maintained, because they're going to keep the building, according to the last meeting, for 7 years.
Yeah.
They want to take the money for maintenance and use it to move to Frontier.
So they want to take the $39,000 and move plus money from each town?
No, that is $39,000.
That is the
$39,000. That's everybody's money. I think 10 is Whately's percentage.
Yeah, but I mean, it's in their budget. It's just, it's not new appropriation. It's just.
And that just to move, or is that to, well, it says make repairs that to the.
I think that they were going to use that for air conditioning.
Well, that was over here, but.
No, at the Frontier.
The Frontier.
Well, if they don't use it, they're going to have to get money somewhere else, to do all what they want to do.
Right, it's kind of catch 22. They're waiting for the boiler to go on Christian Lane.
Yep.
So they'll come to us for boiler money.
Right.
So you're saying.
By the way, they're going to come to us for boiler money regardless of whether they're in that building or not.
Right, that's what I'm saying. They're keeping it for 7 years, they said, to maintain records.
We can have a better place to warm here.
That's a topic for.
Not me. Okay, but you're saying the 6,000 is part of the 39,000 that they have?
Six or 10, what did you say?
Yes. There's $6,100
remaining.
Yeah, I believe that's Whately's percentage of the 39.
That is Whately's percentage of, that is Whately's amount of the 39.
Okay, if that's true, I guess I don't have a problem with it, but if that's not true, then I guess I'd like to know where the rest of the money's coming from, or what's the total going to be.
I put in the request for clarification.
Yeah.
So this will come up because there's going to need to be a vote to put it on a special town meeting warrant. So this can come up.
We don't have to, right. We're not going to decide this tonight.
No, okay.
Because, how much is a new boiler?
$60,000.
How many people are going to be working in that school?
Zero.
Sure.
I know. I've been following it closely.
I've been shuddering.
We can rent space here for a lot less than that.
Right. Well, why don't we try to get to that kind of a...
They own the building.
A discussion.
They own the building.
No, but I mean, rent, they were interested here. Paul made a comment about renting space here in our building just for storing their records. And lock down the old building.
Where?
It up.
Where would you store?
In the center area.
Oh my Lord, we did not buy this building to be a storage compartment. It is not a, what do you call those stupid things?
If it comes to that, we didn't decide anything. That was just an idea. If it comes that we have extra space here that's not being used for anything else.
Well, it's going to be for, it's not a pod.
Well, that's an option to use the space. We're not there yet, but...
Not as far as I'm concerned, it's not.
It would be a lot cheaper for everybody than them trying to maintain and secure that building.
Did I give it that?
Yes. So, okay, so you wanted to, okay, present these 10 items to see how long it would take for a town meeting to decide on?
I just want
special town meeting.
To inform you guys of topics that are likely to come up.
Is there any mention on there of the?
And to have a.
$1,200. The $1,200 that we had from the town garage roof, so that we could reward that money. They never got used. And apparently it needs to be reworded so we can use it for the structural engineer to look at the foundation, etc.
Yeah, it should be on there.
That's an idea, yeah.
Okay.
And however we word it, just open it up so it's general building.
All right, what else is on here?
Yeah.
Let's keep going down the agenda.
Okay, so getting back for the special town meeting, then we need to decide on the topics so we can tell people what we're looking for.
No, that's just a draft, isn't it?
What? You're talking about the information session?
Information session.
Oh. Yeah.
Right.
You're going back to the information session.
Yeah.
Town hall. I think you mentioned town hall.
Water, town hall.
Conway project.
Conway
school design.
We don't need to make, I mean, okay. If we can't think about them right now, maybe it's not important enough to.
Okay, is it just them three? Is that Conway and do we want to throw complete streets in there? Is Keith going to have anything?
I don't think so.
No? Okay. Just Conway, town hall, Conway, okay. Do we want to do anything with the ambulance? I mean, not as far as the location,
years.
But of Zach telling us how great things are going? Or?
I think we can invite him, but it's going to open up a kettle of fish.
Okay,
so I think we should pass on
that. Okay, so just them three for now. I know for two, we'll have to do some more talking with the ad hoc committee and the Conway school to see. Okay. So we'll limit it to them three. Okay. Office relocation. Buy recycling policy. Vote to approve.
All right. Let's do F and H together if that's okay. Because they're related.
Okay.
One is, I'm going to ask you that this is an agreement with the Mass DEP that will allow us to collect our recycling dividends grant, which is $29,000.
Okay.
So that is a formula based grant where the town gets money. It goes into a recycling revolving fund.
To do what with?
You can buy, it's really needs to be related to recycling, so you can buy things for the transfer station by recycling bins, those types of things.
Those bins, those bins are going to go at some point.
Yeah.
We could fix them, because we've had to go find money for those bins in the past.
$29,000.
I'm
sorry,
$2,900.
Oh. $2,900.
Sorry.
No.
But
you could pay bins.
Right.
I thought it was going to be one who could actually do something with it.
At first, I thought you were talking about the little blue recycling bins. I was like, but.
No, I was talking about the.
There is a, I want to say there's close to 40,000 or 50,000 in the recycling fund, the recycling revolving fund.
For the town of Whately?
Yeah, I believe so.
Okay.
So of course, I could be dead wrong. Is
just Fred have to sign that as?
I would, if you both, if both of you just sign.
Okay, and then what else?
Paul's not here. And in relation to that, the Franklin County Solid Waste District was in, who is coordinating this whole thing, asked if we would adopt a revised purchasing, revised recycling purchasing policy. Mass DEP wants specific language on the policies now in order for us to get those future grants.
Meaning? You lost me.
Right.
Maybe
so
because it just
a prerequisite to us getting a recycling dividends program grant is that we have a compliant recycling purchasing policy in place.
That we don't currently have.
Okay, do you have draft language?
Yeah, that's there.
Oh, that's this.
Yeah. This is also, we also need to sign, this is the warrant for the November election, right?
November election, yeah.
That also needs to be signed. And while you're thinking about that, we have a request from the...
Why aren't we doing 100% post-consumer recycled content?
Because 30% is all that's required, I guess. I guess, I don't know what the price differences are.
It's pretty substantial, the price difference.
Yeah, but, I mean...
We can go above and beyond that if we so choose.
Let's do non-dye paper.
It's more money.
What?
More money, I left a call.
I was being somewhat tongue-in-cheek.
Okay, so...
So we have the, I guess it's an annual request, I haven't been around here long enough to know.
It's an annual request.
That the Whately Snowmobile Club be given permission to use the parking lot on Route 5 across from Zanoni's Garage.
Only the snow. They haven't had to use it much.
And there's a letter to that effect.
Yeah, no problem there, but we talked some about our liability for different events on town property, and I think Mark got some information on limits and stuff, and I don't know if we ever resolved that. And coming up with a policy on the use and liability.
Right. Nothing ever came of that.
That wasn't...
Most organizations carry their own liability.
I assume this organization has that.
I don't know.
Liability policy.
I would doubt it personally, but... I mean, Brian can check.
They're not here. I guess I would delay it until they come to another meeting. But
when people use our property for any number of things, we that's why we have liability insurance for the town.
Okay.
I mean, it's no different than anyone else using our. We have liability
softball
insurance.
Softball games.
Sorry.
Softball games.
Whatever it is.
Right.
You know, my guess is that the and I could be wrong, but do we know that the fire association has liability insurance, and if they do a muster at Whately,
yeah,
it's no different. And I think we have town property has liability insurance.
I think Brian would need to check on that, because if I remember correctly, Mark found out. I mean, it's the fire department is a town function,
but the association's not.
Yeah, but it's still related to a town function, where the snowmobile club has nothing to do.
It's a private organization.
It's a private organization.
And what's the Grange?
It's the same thing. And that was the problem, why you guys didn't come to any resolution in terms of the insurance, because of what the insurance
Right. I just think it's a slippery slope because it's the Grange. It's the Historical Society. There's many different organizations that and we want them to use our facilities. And we shame on us, we don't encourage them to use our facilities. And
I would like to hear if somebody from the snowmobile club tell us what their liability policy is, if they have one, before we decide on this. And I don't know where it stands on our priority list to finalize that policy on liability issues, whatever we had before, so.
I don't remember either.
I can't recall.
Okay.
But.
In the future months, we'll talk about it maybe. Okay. What else? Town administrator updates.
I'll keep these short. The rear of the town hall has been painted. That was done in 2 days in the end of September. And then, in terms of the office build out, we're pursuing the construction of the permanent wall that's going to divide the high bay space from the office space to try to make our heating more efficient. And we've got an original estimate, and that came in at $17,000. So that means that we need to go out and get, we need to release the invitation for bids and price quotes. That went out September 28th with responses and price quotes due back October 14th. So at that time, we'll need to consider whoever the low bidder is.
Okay.
And that's really about it.
Okay.
I guess if there's, we'll have to see. But that's enough for tonight.
Yes. Motion to adjourn.
I'll decide on a special town meeting next time, I guess.
We can set a date next time, yeah.
Okay. So in the meantime, we're just going to look at November. One or two of the dates in November.
Yeah, free cash likely won't be certified until November, likely.
You may want to consider a quick meeting. I think we were talking about October 19th because...
Possibly.
If to do a special town meeting, we need two weeks posting. And I don't want to get too far into towards Thanksgiving.
Right.
So we were thinking maybe a quick 8 a.m. meeting.
Right.
8 a.m. meetings are really hard for me these days.
Okay. 8:30?
No, I mean...
Just in general.
In general.
I'm not available that week. At all, not until the following week.
Well, Paul could be here.
So that would make you the 14th. Is our...
Well, we're not going to even know if to award the contract until the 14th. So if we can do it the 5th, we can award the contract for the wall. That following week, they could get started. Want it that much sooner.
So what?
But you'd have to have that at a special. No, that wouldn't have to be a special meeting because you got money out of your phone.
Right.
Okay.
So what date are you looking for to do this?
The 19th.
And Paul can't do Mondays. Well, he can do Wednesday nights.
He could do Wednesdays. But
right.
Does any time in the morning work for you, John?
No, it just doesn't.
Okay.
So Paul can't do Mondays anymore?
No, he can't. I was wrong. I was thinking Tuesdays and Thursdays. He can't do Tuesday, Thursday.
Because he teaches.
You're in Worcester on the 17th.
He's teaching.
That's Greenfield. Maybe it might be. You should just coordinate by email.
Yeah, we can coordinate, but
yeah.
Do you have anything you can tell me right off for that week?
I mean, I could do Wednesday at 6.
Okay.
Six.
Okay.
With some flexibility.
What is it you need for that meeting?
To award the contract for the wall.
Yeah.
And decide on the special town meeting.
Oh, decide on the
would be the 2.
I mean, do you need a meeting for that?
Yeah. To award the contract, you do.
You do?
You need a vote.
You need a vote?
Yep. Right.
But for a special town meeting, you need about 2 weeks notice?
Correct.
So if you did it the 19th, that way you could do it on the 14th. Well, you could still do it on the meeting on the 26th.
I just it would be helpful to have a little flexibility on that because it's free cash. I mean, Ray seemed fairly confident when he left tonight, so... Potentially within the next week to week and a half, we could have notification of the free cash.
But you're only talking of a week ahead of time.
But we also, to post the warrant, we also need to meet with the finance committee. I mean, to pull this all together, there's a lot of coordination that needs to be done.
I mean, we're talking a 5-minute meeting here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Nothing's going to be discussed. We're going to award a contract and we're going to set a date.
And that's fine, but depending on what the date is, we may have a draft warrant that needs to be looked at. It depends on the day. I just want some little flexibility. We'll keep it as short as we can.
So should we be telling finance that they need to meet between the 14th? By the 14th right now is a safe time, whether it's 2 weeks later or not. Well, you at least met the date, but or had a meeting.
I'd like to meet as soon as
possible under the timeframe.
Why don't we implement what I think was a really great strategy and just have a joint meeting so we can talk about all this stuff rather than...
We could, but it's going to be long.
You're saying that now as we're pushing, you know, 2.5 hours.
I know, but you can't make an 8 o'clock meeting, and you got 30 minutes on a Wednesday. So I'm just saying, your calendar seems probably more full than anybody's.
Right, but I could, I mean, Wednesday night, we could do that. I could do that.
Okay.
I could figure that out.
All right. Well, like I'm saying, we should try to make it happen as soon as possible, so for the...
Well, I guess I'd like to do that meeting if you're going to talk to finance over some of these issues. And you're only talking the following week, another week. I mean, you could still meet your 5 minutes to approve stuff on the 19th, and we can meet with finance the following week after our regular meeting if you want, or some other time that week, I guess.
No, well,
you know, we had a conversation that it would be, I think, helpful to you guys if it went through finance first, so that instead of coming to us with your recommendation, it should come from us to you, because you're the final say.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I'm just, and again, I'm amazed that we're meeting for 2.5 hours tonight, but because we've never done that before. But,
well, the brew house alone was... That was entertainment.
I thought we all had a really good concept around, rather than you coming to us or us coming to you,
meeting on the same footing.
That's fine.
And because I really think that promotes that communication, which we all agreed has been lacking historically.
It has. That's
true. So if we could all get together, and yes, we're the final arbiter, but you guys are going to recommend what you recommend, and we're, you know, let's have a conversation.
I'm fine. I'm fine with that. Let's get it going.
Yeah.
So let's do that on the 26th, then, our next meeting. Can we do it then?
We can.
After our regular selectman meeting?
No, during.
Or during?
During. During. Not after. During.
Be prepared. It's going to be a long meeting, because you're going from October 3rd to the 26th. That's a long time to go, and I suspect it's going to be a fairly hefty agenda for you guys just to begin with, let alone to deal with a joint meeting of the finance committee. I mean, you only had one meeting in September, which is why we had a big agenda tonight.
But we'd have to meet that week to approve the warrant articles, I guess, right? Because you need 2 weeks' notice, so it would have to be sometime that week, whether you meet on a Wednesday night or... Paul can't do it Tuesday and Thursdays, right? So you're back to Monday or Friday.
Okay, so why don't we'll have some more information on the 19th and as we get closer, so we can probably coordinate a time as we get a little bit more information. But you might want to consider a separate meeting just to deal with the special town meeting, because there's a lot of information to discuss. So why don't we establish it? We at least have the 19th, at least a brief meeting, and then we can kind of go from there.
Okay, but then I would respectfully request that we really start to coordinate our meetings going forward.
Yeah.
Because we are going to be approaching budget season, and I know none of us want to all of a sudden be in budget season and be confronted with the same lack of communication that we've had before. And I'm just trying to be good neighbors, like, and I know you guys want to be good neighbors, and but as long as we can agree that we got to start to meet together, I wish we could be doing it as we approach a special that is going to have some financial implications to the town, maybe not catastrophic ones, but
you just can't kill people with a meeting time, you know, everybody's got a limit, and if we, you know, I mean, we're 2.5 hours tonight, and so it could easily be a 3-4 hour meeting.
And I don't want that.
Yeah, I don't think anybody wants that.
Okay, whatever you guys have to say.
Motion to adjourn.
Second. All right.